environment and scrutiny committee. Night is cold, the room is warm, so we might do something about that now. To my left and right are the officers, on the sides are members, and I'm trying to put right on the chair. I'll do my best to keep this meeting in order and leave things swiftly on. Are there any preparations of interest?
Chair, I'll declare a non-beneficial interest in the fact that I'm a director, so all director of Chairs Living.
No, that's fantastic. Okay, the minutes, are members happy with those? Well, I'm not.
On page 10, on page 10, item 36, it gives the names of the people in the task of the finish group, which, if you look further on in the paperwork on page 85, you'll see that it doesn't, it's not the same as what's shown in 3.42. So I would want clarification of who is on that. Modern slavery review. Please.
Make that clarification.
It's just the councillors in the work programme item of the councillors in the work programme. So, it's a program. But the councillors in the work programme, 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 the councillors in
the work programme. Okay. Those questions can be made. That's fine. Nothing else? Okay, then we'll move on to agenda item 3, which is the Magenta Health Association impacted the welfare reform. It's going to be presented by Brian Simpson and John Bridge. If you want to take it away, that's fine.
Standards. We were set up with that as our original original intention. So by March of last year, we spent just under £194 million bringing our homes up to modern standards. Just some of the figures there, almost 9,000 new bathrooms, 9,000 kitchens, 7,000 bathrooms, over 6,000 central heating systems, and 12,000 properties with double glazed windows and doors. So that was very much our first 10 years in terms of delivering the promises we made to our tenants and the council at transfer to bring homes up to modern standards. We are a large organisation. We have something like just under 500 staff. We have a turnover of over 62 million. Our vision is about providing homes and building communities. It is very much about, we're not just bricks and mortar, and we'll try and pick that up towards the end. It is very much about having sustainable communities across the world. So whilst we've invested quite a lot in bricks and mortar improvements, it's also about improving services and community cohesion. We let something like 1,300 homes a year, and since transfer, we've built over 750 new homes across the world. So that's a little bit about Magenta Living in terms of background. The meat of the presentation today was about welfare reform and its effect on our tenants, and we broke it down into the various areas. We have just over 12,000 current tenants, almost 4,000 pensioners who have not really been affected by the welfare reforms at this stage, but I'll come on to it on a later slide. There are changes to do with the local housing allowance, which will start to affect pensioners. We've got about 3,000 tenants who are not reliant on benefits to pay their rent. And we've got about 5,000 working age households who are on housing benefit or universal credit. So about 70% of our tenants receive some form of benefit to help them pay their rent. The first area of welfare reform was the under occupation deduction, commonly known as the bedroom tax. We currently have about 1,700 tenants who are subject to the under occupation deduction. By far away, the biggest amount are those that are deemed to under occupy by one bedroom, and that's a 14% deduction, so something like about £12 a week deduction for being under occupied by one bedroom. And the smaller number, 362, who have a two bedroom deduction, which amounts to about £22 a week. This has come down dramatically since the under occupation deduction was introduced in April 2013. We had just under 2,500 tenants that were subject to the deduction. And in the early stages, many of our tenants were able to avail themselves of discretionary housing payments, but those awards over the last 3 years have reduced by almost 60%. We have about 16% of our tenants receive some form of DHP support. In many cases, we housed a number of people that were subject to the deduction that wanted to move to smaller accommodation. Others have left and gone elsewhere, moved back with family, etc. But probably the 1,700 now that we've got are advising us that they're getting by. So they continue to want to live in their current homes and have the deduction from their benefits and continue to pay their rent. We are aware that DHP, there is a government grant, it can be topped up by councils, but in Wirral's case, Wirral doesn't top up that benefit, the DHP pot. So potentially other households could be assisted if that were the case. The next area is universal credit. This is the rollout the government's bringing, where they're bringing six benefits together into to one payment paid direct to the tenant, and that includes housing benefit. So this is, as I say, being rolled out. Currently, Wirral in its pilot state, we have just under 500 households who are currently in receipt of universal credit. At the moment, collection rates are quite high. We collect 99% of the rent income from those that have the housing benefit now paying directly to the arrears. About 40% of the universal credit cases are on what's known as alternative payment arrangements. So the idea is that initially the universal credit is paid directly to the tenant, but if they get into 8 weeks arrears or if they have other issues, we can apply for alternative payment arrangements, which is basically paying the rent directly to us as the landlord. Bit of a mixed picture, I think with the number of new tenants coming in that automatically go to universal credit, we have seen rent arrears increase as a percentage of the household arrears, whereas I think the intensive work that our team has worked with some people that have been in arrears from the start, we have actually reduced the numbers in arrears from 384 cases down to just under 360. I think there are a number of issues that we have to work around as a landlord in terms of collecting our rent, and one of those is that there's no payment for the first days, the first 7 days, and then it's paid calendar monthly in arrears. So we do find from experience that tenants do fall into arrears quite early, and whilst we do work with them on a range of areas, particularly in giving them debt counselling advice, etc., both benefits advice and household income advice, it does take about 12 months for the tenants, once they get into arrears, to actually be able to clear their arrears. The next area is the benefit cap. This was introduced in November of last year. This is where people's combined benefits cannot exceed £20,000 a year. This was originally £26,000, that came down to £20,000, as I say, at the back end of last year. This has brought about 73 households of Magenta Living tenants are affected. It was only 11 when it was at 26,000 rate. It does depend on the range of benefits that people have claimed in the past. So the amount of the deduction from benefits varies from very little to almost, in some cases, people had a range of benefits that took them well over the 20,000 range, that all of their rent or their housing benefit payment is deducted. We are slowly working round to see all of our tenants that are affected. We've interviewed 47 at the minute, and I suppose there are three areas that they're looking at. Many are looking to find work. I think the other issue is that we shouldn't lose sight of the fact that many people who are on low incomes get benefits, so they do actually have jobs, maybe limited hours work, so many of those are looking to increase their hours if they can, and many are saying they will have to just manage. So clearly we try and give as much support and assistance as we can to ensure that tenants can actually budget for their rent and for their household expenditures. And I think we have quite a close working relationship with the council, and I think we've been advised that the council will look favourably to using discretionary housing payments for those that are seriously affected by the benefit cap. Other factors, we've got council tax support. I think the council took a decision that all residents would have to pay something towards their council tax in the Wirral contribution rate at 22%. That affects about 2,000 Magenta Living households. So for a tenant in a Band B property, they're now paying about £267 a week out of their benefits, which obviously clearly, again, eats into their income in terms of paying their rent and other household expenditure. And the last area is local welfare assistance. Obviously this has been usually received by families when they have a crisis issue such as needing a cooker or whatever. We've noticed that really our tenants don't benefit greatly from local welfare assistance. About £17,000 in claims in the previous 2015 year, but actually this year so far less than £900. So that's a very quick counter through the benefits, the main benefits and how they affect housing associations, levying rent and collecting rent. Just in terms of impact on services and tenants, I think what we have seen over the last 16 years or so is very much an increase in tenants terminating tenancies on affordability grounds. I think many find a struggle to actually budget with reduced welfare benefits. And particularly we've seen an increase in tenants who have terminated not to go and live in another housing association property or whatever, or a private renting, which we do get quite a few people terminating, but quite an increase in people going back to live with family on the basis that they feel that they cannot afford to live on their own. We have had some more evictions, but it's still comparatively low figure. We've always been less than about 20 evictions, and in most years it is very much the last sanction that we would anticipate, but clearly they're starting to increase as people, some people, do not make arrangements with us to make arrears payments. I think because we've had more people actually leaving our stock, we've found that we've had a lot more vacancies, empty homes. As people leave, and with reduced demand in some areas, for particular types of property as well, two-bed flats, three-bedroom flats are very difficult to let with under-occupation criteria in mind. And in some areas, some of the less popular areas, people have voted with their feet and we've struggled to actually let some properties, particularly where we've had a high concentration, again, of three-bedroom houses where people have been affected by the under-occupation deduction. So that's meant we've had much higher repair costs, because obviously when we get an empty home, we have to do repairs to re-let it, and we've obviously had a lot of lost rental whilst the property is empty. And probably the last point on that, this particular slide to point out is that in the past we have housed some family groups, particularly single people that might have access to children, in appropriate sized accommodation where they could have children at weekends and the like, but clearly in terms of welfare benefits based on bedroom sizes, those people would not be able to maintain the tenancy of a two-bed or a three-bedroom flat. So we have had difficulty being able to house couples and particularly single people that have access to children to give them spare bedrooms to take in their children. Moving on, I think what we're finding is that we are using far more resources to help people in terms of welfare benefit advice, particularly helping our tenants apply for DHB. As we've said, we're reducing success as there's more strains put on the DHB budgets. As I said a few moments ago also, we're finding a lot more resources in supporting universal credit claimants. Because obviously many have to apply online, it's very difficult to get the information together, so we very much work intensively with residents to be able to get them to support their claims. There is the move to a full online system from November this year where all claims will have to be made online. We wonder about some of our residents' ability to be able to do that. Many do not have access to computers in their own homes, or have issues about digital literacy, I suppose. But also, the full rollout, at the minute it is only partially universal credit rollout, but when it fully rolls out, rather than having just under 500 cases at the moment, we anticipate just under 6,000 cases who will go on to universal credit. So that will impact on our resources to be able to provide our intensive approach to help people claim universal credit and ensure that they can budget and make their rent and other household payments. So because of that, we've given a lot more to support to people at risk of losing their homes. We've actually helped families challenge sanctions from DWP. We help to try and consider other benefits that they may be able to apply for, personal independence payments, etc. But because of our focus on helping those that are at risk of losing their homes, part of the trade-off of that has been that we have a reduced ability to provide saying is, whilst we perform well now, there are obviously some challenges on the horizon. Well, I can give them as a credit. What will the role of GHP be on this? How will we resource that with our colleagues at the council? Online systems, how many of our residents will be able to manage this? What will be the DUP's response should residents not claim appropriately, and obviously the impact on our income? Now, clearly, because income is one of our top priorities, we continue to put resources and make priority resources in order to make sure that our residents can claim their benefits and pay their rent. But clearly that has an impact on how we do parts of the other business. Future changes, and I referred to this a bit earlier. The government's brought in the local requirements cap. What this is, that social landlords' rents will be capped to the local housing allowance level, which is the figure that is used to fix rents in the private sector. And all social rents should be within that, that cap. And that is fine for most of our general needs accommodation. Our rents are much lower than private sector rents, and are within that range quite comfortably. But specialist accommodation, sheltered housing or supported housing, where we provide extra services to help people maintain their independence, so extra care schemes and supported housing schemes, the rent and the service charge in the main is over the LHA cap. So this will actually start to impact on some of our elderly residents who thus far have not been subject to any welfare reform reductions. And in terms of working out rents, pensioners in two-bedroom properties will only get the one-bedroom local housing allowance, but clearly there is an issue about what happens when some of our sheltered and supported housing, which has higher rents and service charges which are over the LHA level, how will that work? Well, the government is reviewing this at the moment. There's a consultation exercise going on. They have suggested they may well bring in a DHP type system where those tenants that are affected by the LHA cap can apply for specialist funding, which will be allocated to local authorities. It's very much in its early stages. This is being consulted upon. But I think one of the issues for us in this area, as other landlords in the north of England, local housing allowance levels, because they are based on private sector rents, are much lower in this area than they are in, say, London and the South East, where the same system will apply. So clearly there is a bigger gap to be covered by any arrangement to pick up that gap, such as a discretionary housing payment type system. So this is something that's coming up on the radar. We're well aware of this and working with other providers to look at our response to that future change. So that's the welfare reform. The second part of the presentation was about supporting the council vision, and I'm just conscious of the time, so I will very quickly take this through. But we've looked at the council's 2020 vision document, and we feel that there's a number of areas where we actually assist the council now and can continue to assist. So in terms of people pledges, older people living well, well, we've mentioned our direct provision of shelter accommodation in many locations, our tenancy support service, and our support link service, which I always call our warm and cold service. That's the old-fashioned name for it, giving a response, and we feel that that's a service that can develop further to pick up increasing needs of our elderly population in Wirral. Pledge 3, young people ready to go work in adulthood. We have a number of partnership schemes with schools. We have apprenticeships and work experience, and we work with children's services to ensure the care leavers are offered accommodation. Pledge 5, reducing child and family poverty. We have our financial inclusion team. We actually host Partners Credit Union in our building that offers savings plans and low-cost home insurance schemes. We work with a number of partners on employment skills and enterprise projects. People pledge number 6, people with disabilities have to live independently. We've got our adaptation service where we assess a range of requirements, and in the last year we've had just under 1,200 adaptations. We spend just under £500,000 a year making adaptations to ensure people In terms of business pledges, well, again, I think very quickly whipping through this, we are a major employer in the borough, almost 500 staff. We have continued to support an apprenticeship scheme right since transfer. We currently employ 10 apprentices across the piece, many in our building services operation, but across the business as well. We've always committed to staff training, and we're investing people, IIP Gold Award for staff development. And in terms of having a skilled workforce, we obviously through our training programme put a number of staff through various qualifications, but particularly about digital technology, rolling out new ways of working using mobile technology, which I think leaves our people in a lot more skilled position than they started with. And then just moving on, the environmental pledges, which possibly this select scrutiny committee would be interested in. Wirral residents living healthy lives. We have a number of schemes that we run. We have about 30 odd residents associations across the borough. We have 13 community properties. These are houses, such as a house on the Binston Rise estate or a shop on the Woodchurch estate, where we actually have our residents group space. And they work with a range of other service providers to support various schemes in terms of physical learning, people with physical disabilities, learning disabilities, supporting a range of programmes from healthy eating to supporting stop smoking projects. Very much about that, providing homes and building communities. Pledge number 18, good quality housing. Well, again, I think probably I don't need to say too much about that. From spending £193 million bringing our homes up to a modern standard, our adaptations every year, I think we feel that we have really brought our stock up to a modern-day standard, and I think we can do more to help the council in bringing up other stock within the borough up to standard and building new homes. Pledge 19, Wirral's neighbourhoods are safe places. We've always invested in tackling antisocial behaviour, and we take tenancy enforcement very strongly, and at any one time we have about 120 active cases where we take action to enforce tenancy agreements, and it's always cited by our tenancy surveys that it's a very worthwhile service that tenants appreciate in terms of dealing with tackling antisocial behaviour. But clearly antisocial behaviour in its widest instance, we work with a range of other partners including the council's teams but the police as well. And then environmental pledge 20, attractive local environments for rural residents. We have a number of schemes where we clearly have quite a stockholding of grassed areas and landscaped areas which we pride ourselves on keeping and maintaining. And we have a service that we offer to residents who aren't able to do their own gardens. We've got a handyman's service. And we have an environmental team that keeps on top of fly tipping, graffiti, and actually pest control in some areas we've intervened more directly where we've had issues. So I'm conscious I've gone at quite a pace here to get through everything, but in conclusion, I think Magenta Living is more than bricks and mortar, and we do provide a wide range of services, and we plan to build a lot more homes within the borough. But clearly, I think part of the focus for today was about welfare reform. Welfare reform continues to be a challenge, not just for our tenants, but for the organisation. It continues to obviously take substantial amounts out of tenants' income, which affect their ability to pay rent. It's also money that isn't spent in the local economy. But we are very much committed to assisting tenants to actually have maximise their income to both pay their rent and their other
that said, I'll open up to the committee. Steve?
Yeah, interested in the high intensity that you put into the people on universal credits, and I just want to know from the council's point of view whether we're experiencing similar difficulties with that cohort in terms of the money we need to collect in terms of the council tax, and whether we're putting any, or is it the point I'm making? Are we generally getting their rents, but we're not getting our council tax, or vice versa? And I guess the theme I've always sort of had in my mind is that in many ways the council, Magenta, utilities are all trying to chase the same pot of money from the same individuals. And when we go live with universal credits, I'm just wondering whether there's any inroads been made about joint working, being able to spread that resource issue across all organisations, and somehow if talks haven't started or relationships opened up, whether there's any mileage in beginning that sort of thing, because it's it is going to hit. And I was liking it when I was young. When I got paid monthly when I was young, I was a millionaire for a week. And I was skinned the best in the month, and I always had to go around bottom off my mum or my dad. So it is a sense, as basic a human instinct as that we will be trying to cope with. So I'm just wondering what relationships have been developed, or is any mileage in developing those sort of cases, say in cash.
Okay, thank you, Steve. Brian, John, I'm mindful that you know where they are, Mike. Could I ask?
Yeah, very good, sir.
Perhaps when we have occupied one state. For 6 or 7 months, effectively. And that's why when Brian gave his presentation, he was saying that we see a spike in arrears and then a slow reduction as people get on top of it. I'm sure the same happens with council tax and a lot of other bills. We're always, when we're talking to people in arrears, we're always very conscious about the fact that it's very important to pay your council tax, because if you don't, you're going to see those consequences. So we would always raise that as, this is a priority debt, rent is also council taxes, any fines. We make sure that they understand those things. In terms of could other people help, well, our welfare benefit scheme are under pressure now. And we are, as Brian said, the non-urgent cases, they're waiting longer and longer before we can get to see them, and that can only increase, really. So I think the pooling of people that can help with welfare advice, budgeting advice, would be a great thing. And how that could be called coordination, I don't know, but I think that's going to become more important as time goes on with universal credit.
Okay, thank you. Indulgence to the chair. I gather from your presentation that you expect once universal credit is properly rolled out, you may encounter a problem with arrears at some point. If this is something that you suspect you may encounter, have you made any plans around managing the demand for assistance to your residents?
What we think will happen is there'll be a spike. At the moment, the level of
hearing of it. It's quite basic, and it can't cover the complicated cases. So a lot of people who apply to university cricket at this stage will be rejected and be told, you know, go and claim job seekers allowance or employment support allowance, because the system couldn't cope with the complications of those. The live system, it copes with that. So every new claim will be accepted and will go through. So we'll see an increase in November. The real increase though will be when they start migrating claims. So it's rather than just new claims, it's when they start writing to people and saying, right, we can take you off your job seekers allowance and put you on universal credit. And it's how quickly that rollout commences. There's a danger that could overwhelm us, but also potentially the DWP as well. So that's the real worry then, because we have to put a lot of resources in the start of claims. We have to make sure that people understand what they have to pay, when they have to pay it, and so that's about how they're going to pay it. And we can do that with the numbers coming through at the moment, but if we got 100, 200, 300 a week coming through, there's no way we could do that. This just physically would not be possible. So that's a real concern. It's just the rate that changeover takes place. We can only hope that the DWP recognise that, because it's going to overwhelm them as well. So that needs to be, that's a real worry for us. And planning for that, without knowing what that rate will be, it's hard to plan for it.
Okay, thank you. Mike.
Thank you, Chair. Thanks, Brian, for an excellent presentation. The content was excellent. But it was bleak. Goodness me, it was bleak. I've got so many questions I'd like to ask. One of my main concerns is when it goes to a full online system, and Magenta, in my opinion, Magenta are a fantastic social housing provider. You know, you cover all the bases, you've got all the advice you give people, and it's all intense as far as you're concerned from your workforce, which is just under 500. So when it goes to completely online, you know as well as I do, there's people out there who are IT illiterate. But you've also got, and this goes to the universal credit as well, that's why you guys, you're under attack really. I see it as being under attack, because when it goes to the fully online system for claiming benefits, you're going to have the IT illiterates, you're going to have people who are going to get all the benefits sent to them. You're also going to get, and Steve outlined, you know, what we all did as kids, I'm sure. You've got your drug addicts, your alcoholics, and we know the proliferation in gambling addiction. So you as an organisation, you're going to have to employ social workers. But my main concern is your total income is in rents. Now, your rents are going to be severe, and I've used the word under attack, they're going to diminish. Now, my concern is, when your income diminishes, you then look at getting rid of staff, to be perfectly honest. So whereby you're handling it now, when the universal credit's rolled out, goodness me, you're going to have a job and a half. How have you planned to bring that in when every claimant, everything is now going to be done online? The other thing, if you'll indulge me, Chair, the other question, I've got some, a spotlight session would be really good.
I would have let you come back, so you don't need to make all the questions.
Just one more then, and I'm not going to come back anyway. Can you comment on, the government are going to roll out right to buy. This is also going to hit. You've got 12,500 houses now. So when the government increase the right to buy to social housing tenants, that again, what's going to happen to the capital when these people, well, at 70% discount anyway, but what's going to happen to that capital? Is that going to go into your business? And how are you going to cope with that?
presentation, income is our main issue because we can't do anything without income. So I think our board have been very clear that we've got to make sure that we maintain income collection. As John said, I think what will happen is it won't be a big bang, it'll be a gradual rollout. You will probably have to put short-term more resources in to help John and his team to actually keep on top of people as they come on board. It might be, I don't know how long-term that would be, short-term, medium-term or long-term. It might be longer-term. We'll have to increase people in the income collection team to make sure that we can assist people. Because as you say, there's many people that aren't as literate in terms of using computers and the like. Our offices, if you come to Partnership Building, we have the customer hub where residents come, we have a range of IT and we try and help them do it online, but clearly they've got to do it online, so we can't do it for them, but we can assist them. So there's a range of positions where we probably will do some bolster the team short term to make sure that we are able to provide that assistance and make that smooth transition. But I think, as John said, I think we think it'll be a gradual transition, because I think, as well as us being overwhelmed, as John said, PWP would be overwhelmed. So I think we would deal with that, and as I say, we would continue to monitor that. The second question about the rollout of right to buy. Because we're a stock transfer organisation, back in 2005, all of our tenants had the right to buy.